Welcome to PETV Presentations. This is episode 14 of season one. Today we have joining with us Paul Wheaton. Paul is the tyrannical dictator of permies.com, the largest permaculture forum on the web. As a certified master gardener and permaculture designer, he's built an empire around what he calls infecting brains with permaculture. His forums are full of rich information, and there are a number of great free resources, guides, and articles that can be found on his sister site, richsoil.com. So check those guys out, permies.com and richsoil.com. Check them out. There's tons of information, great information. And Permiethos is, we're building a forum on there. So we'll have a forum on there as well. We're partnering up with Paul, and that's pretty exciting on doing that. Well, Paul, I met Paul. Boy, I can't even remember the first time I met you. It was a while ago. The culture thing? That wasn't the first time I met you, but that's the first time we really interacted. And that was Sepp Holzer did a workshop at in Polson, in Montana, a town called Polson. And that was an awesome, awesome encounter. It was great to meet Sepp and Paul. And Jack Spirico was there too. So that was a ton of fun. But welcome to the show, Paul. What do you got for us today?
All right. You told me to put together a presentation. So I did. Let's see if I can make it happen. Clickety click, click, click.
Oh, by the way, guys, before we jump into this too much, it is very possible there will be foul language in this.
It's beautiful.
It is beautiful. We are not afraid of language in this episode. So just giving you the heads up in case you got kiddos around. I know some of you bring kids. If you find it offensive, some language offensive, then you may not want to expose your children to this. So, disclaimer ahead.
So yeah, we will. I'm glad to enrich the lives of your children using nothing but the English language. All right. Can you see this?
Yes.
All right. So then what I want to try to do is basically introduce rocket mass heaters, but kind of through the back door. What I want to do is I want to address some of the criticisms that there have been about rocket mass heaters. And along the way, that'll be an educational process of sorts. I went and first learned about rocket mass heaters in 2009. I'd heard about them in 2008. I signed myself up for a workshop. I went, in fact, before going, the things I were told were weird, so I wanted to try and see it on YouTube or see it as a video online somewhere. There was basically nothing available. So I think I put the very first rocket mass heater videos up on YouTube. I think I also wrote the first article to appear on the internet. And then I've added, I think, about 20 rocket mass heater videos to YouTube. I then became one of the innovators. I did a bunch of modifications to rocket mass heaters, which then worked out. And then I hosted some of the innovator events. In 2012, I had a video camera and I recorded a workshop and we put it into this 4 DVD set. Sales were amazing. They did really great. People wanted more. So now, just a few weeks ago, we came out with this new 4 DVD set. And so we've got a total of 8 DVDs now about rocket mass heaters. The new DVDs are kind of like, let's squeeze a lot of information in. We tried to not duplicate information that was in the first 4 DVDs. But like, we've also got the first DVD out of that bunch, Building a Cobb-Style Rocket Mass Heater. That one is designed to be a standalone DVD. So if a person's going to buy just one, or they're going to watch just one, that would be the one to watch. What is a rocket mass heater? Just real quick, it's a wood-burning thing. It looks very different from a conventional wood stove. It is a DIY sort of a thing. You could, there have been people who have like hired somebody. In fact, we've had people who bought the DVDs and gave them to their favorite, you know, builder guy. Here you go, builder guy, make me one of these. And so then they didn't exactly do it. They didn't DIY it. They had builder guy build it. And so that's possible. But most people, it's a DIY thing. They're cleaner in multiple ways, much cleaner than a conventional wood stove. And depending on how you hold your ruler up, it's even cleaner than natural gas or electric. More heat is kept into the house. It's one of the ways it's much more efficient. Holds heat for days after the fire goes out. I mean, the biggest thing that we do, the biggest thing, biggest claim, and what a lot of this is going to be about, is heat your home with 1/10 the wood. So if you switch out your conventional wood stove and replace it with a rocket mass heater, then if you're using 8 cords per winter, you're probably going to use less than a cord with the rocket mass heater. How does it do it? And so the key is that with a conventional wood stove, you've got the fire in a box, and you try to get the heat out right away. And you're looking at temperatures of about 800 degrees, 1200 degrees, maybe as high as 1400 degrees. But with a rocket mass heater, we run the fire at a very insulated space, and we are shooting for temperatures well over 2600, preferably even over 3000 degrees. So then there's a chimney of sorts, a squat, super insulated chimney inside of the rocket mass heater, and that's going to create a powerful thermosiphon. And that's like the engine of the rocket mass heater. That's the thing that kind of makes all of this work so well. All right, real quick, I'm going to talk about the Wheaton Eco Scale. This is something where I made something up like 6 years ago, and this graphic artist guy, Olaf, turned it into something beautiful. And the key is like we're going to look at the dandelions today. So I'm hoping that, and once in a while I'm going over here and I'm looking at the chat thing, but I'm hoping you guys can find the part where it says dandelions. If I point, can you see it? Do you see my mouse pointing at stuff here?
Yeah, we see it. And if you want, you can click on annotate on the top, and there's like a follow your mouse thing where it'll actually highlight your mouse.
Okay. Oh, it says turn on the laser pointer.
Oh, that's Google's thing, I think. But yeah, there you go.
Whoa! So you see that? So is that showing up, my little laser pointer?
Yes, it is.
Okay. All right. So basically, the thing is, it's broken up into 10 levels. People at level 0, there are 6 billion of them. At level 1, it isn't showed over here, there is 1 billion. At level 2, there is 100 million. And so the size shrinks by a factor of 10 with each level. So it's a reverse logarithmic scale. But at level 0, people kind of don't care about eco stuff. It's not a big deal to them. They've got other priorities. But they tend to poison dandelions. And then when you get to level 2, then people, there's 100 million of them, and they tend to pull up dandelions. And then at level 4, then they allow dandelions to grow, and there's 1 million people at level 4. And they eat them sometimes, and they, of course, enjoy blowing on the dandelion seed heads. And then you get to level 6, and they exchange dandelion seeds with others to get a really great-tasting dandelion. All right, the point is this. Observation 1, most people will find folks 1 or 2 levels up are pretty cool, 3 levels up are a bit nutty, 4 or 5 levels up, downright crazy, 6 levels up should be probably institutionalized. And then I point out that I think these are inappropriate. the key is that with a rocket mass heater, I think it's totally reasonable that if you're at level 0, that and if a rocket mass heater is at, say, level 6, that's 6 levels up. And you're going to think that whoever's doing this should probably be institutionalized. I think that that is a valid thought for somebody to have. And really the thing to do is that I probably generally should not talk about rocket mass heaters to the general public. I should talk about rocket mass heaters to people that are going to be more likely to hear it. But so then the people that we're going to hear from today are probably level 1, level 2, and then they jumped to a lot of inappropriate conclusions. And all right. Shut up, Bone. So they jumped to a bunch of inappropriate conclusions. I'm going to try to address those. All right. So we make the claim that you can heat your home with 1/10 of wood. We also say maybe just the branches that naturally fall off the trees in your yard. One person heated their home 1 year with nothing but junk mail. So when I first heard about rocket mass heaters, my own skepticism was I didn't understand the sideways burn. I mean, now it's obvious. I think that everybody who's probably, you know, with us today probably has seen a video of the sideways burn, which would have helped me so much when I first started reading about rocket mass heaters. But the next two, I think, really apply, especially to people at level zero. And it's going to be, if it worked, why don't we hear more about it? And if it worked, why is it not sold in stores? So I think my DVDs do a good job of kind of going into the not sold in stores thing. And I think we are hearing more about it. We're getting better and better and better. And it is really taken off. Growth seems to be exponential. That doesn't quite fit on the screen. How weird. All right. We have a lot less skepticism now. And a lot of it comes from the supporting evidence. There's just so many people that have built one. And a lot of times people get up and they start saying crazy things on the internet. And a lot of times I'll see one or two different people coming in and saying, I have one. I've built it. And they say, well, you obviously must have, you know, so it's like, in order to be able to believe your claims that you're heating with 1/10 the wood, how much insulation do you have? And it's kind of like, that doesn't really matter. It's the exact same house. The before and after. Before it was 8 cords of wood, and now it's less than 1 cord of wood. The before and after is using the same house, same insulation, same climate, same comfort level, same fuel, same operator, 1/10 the wood. And so, you know, but that's one of the most important things. We have dozens and dozens and dozens of people, or at least probably about 50 or more people that I've heard from where they dramatically reduced the amount of wood that they used to heat their home. And they went from a conventional rocket or a conventional wood stove to a rocket mass heater. I think a lot of the skepticism is reduced now because the article has been so optimized and so polished. We've got so much information there about all of the different ways that this actually works and the explanation of it. More videos. There's a lot of videos on YouTube that are not a good example of a rocket mass heater build. And even some of my original videos, like we've gotten away from using metal inside the riser. There's some great videos out there. Web for Deb has some where he was really, it showed powerful courage. What he did was is that he had a rocket mass heater failure because he had metal inside his riser. And so he showed the video of the failure and he talked about how it didn't work out. So, you know, please don't use metal inside your riser or inside the burn tunnel. Let's see. Beep, 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 boo. Okay, here we go. Here, I'm going to just go through these quotes real quick and we're going to address some more here in a moment. But here's the four things we're going to lean heavily on for this presentation that came from the skeptic. Used well, a rocket mass heater can be more efficient than a modern wood stove, but only by 10% at most, in my opinion. The 10% figure is from my personal experience and knowledge of thermodynamics. I'm an engineer who consults on building energy efficiency. Wheaton's claims on rocket mass heater efficiency are here, and then she provided a link. Heat your home with 80 to 90% less wood. Current wood stoves have an efficiency of 60 to 78%. And then she goes on to talk about the fundamentals of physics that contradict his views and opinions. She was making a point that I do not have the intellectual capacity to understand the fundamentals of physics that contradict my views. All right, so there's two big ways to respond to this. There's two big approaches. One is the math, starting with the 75% efficient wood stove. And then the other one is to observe what comes out of the chimney of a conventional wood stove and what comes out of the exhaust of a rocket mass heater. So from the math perspective, we start with a wood stove that is labeled 75% efficient. And, you know, the thing I got to point out here is that where it says 75% efficient, note that that's part of the marketing information. This is, you know, so it there could be other information that they put with the wood stove, but this falls directly under marketing. They are trying to sell you a wood stove. So are they going to, like, tell you all the different things about how they got to 75% efficient or what that means? No, because 75% efficient is all. When you go shopping for a conventional wood stove, there's all these different numbers, 75, 68, 72. And so then that's how they choose to compete. And the number means something sitting next to another ridiculous number from another manufacturer. But first thing to point out is that 75% efficient is actually 59%. So they're given 16 percentage points to be the heat that that goes up the chimney to carry the smoke outside. So it's not really 75% efficient, it's really 59%. The next thing to point out is that the labs compete for the testing contracts. And so so they want to provide the best possible numbers, because if they don't provide as good as numbers at the next lab over, then all the business will go to the next lab over, because all these stove manufacturers want to have great numbers. So what are they going to do to try and come up with really great numbers? I don't think any of them actually fudge the numbers, but I do think that they're going to do a bunch of stuff to try to get really, really good numbers, such as they might possibly kiln dry the wood to get the percentage of moisture inside the wood down so incredibly low that the wood is going to burn extra, extra clean and hot. They might also use a variety of wood that has a lot of BTUs per pound, such as black locust. I also suspect, and I have not verified, but I suspect that they probably have a way to adjust the air pressure inside the lab. And so then if they build the air pressure to be really high, then it's kind of as if air is blowing on the fire in, you know, for the lab test. And so then that's going to make it, you know, get you much better numbers also. The next one is going to be if they, instead of putting great big logs on the fire, that they use like almost all kindling, a really small wood, or they stack it very particular way to get a really efficient burn. So, and then they're going to run dozens and dozens of tests. They're going to do it over and over and over and over again until they can find out which is the most efficient burn. Now, in the real world, when the stove gets installed in somebody's house and they're trying to use it, they're going to use a variety of different kinds of wood. It's maybe wet or green. Some of it's going to be kind of punky. And at night, they're very likely to turn the dampers way down, and they'll put a great big log in there. And, of course, if the air for the fire is coming from the house, then the air pressure in the house is going to be reduced. And so then because like a lot of houses today are built like Ziploc bags. They're nearly airtight. And so as air is being pulled from the room to be used in the fire, then the air pressure in the house is reduced, and so now the stove's having a hard time pulling more air into the system, which is going to make it burn less efficiently. Then there's going to be the smoke from the fire in a conventional wood stove, and then creosote can build up. In fact, some of the neat things that they have for making a conventional wood stove more efficient also happen to increase the amount of creosote that builds up in the chimney, and that increases your risk of having a chimney fire. All right. That was, I want to say, you know, normally I'm used to having a bunch of people sitting in front of me and I can look at them and say, all right, we're good. Can we move on to the next thing? But yeah, you guys are all kind of invisible. So I'll just keep going. The next system is going to be the chimney and exhaust system, where we're going to like look and see what comes out. A conventional wood stove, the chimney smoke is usually 300 to 600 degrees to carry all that smoke out there. And if you look at it, there's a lot of it. There's a big, you know, plume of smoke, and it's coming out pretty fast. Rocket mass heater exhaust is usually very cool, and there's not a whole lot of it. I mean, if nothing else, if you just look at the wood feed on a rocket mass heater, it's like for an 8-inch system, which is a very large system, it's going to be 7.1 inches by 7.1 inches, so 7.1 inches square. And then your sticks, it's going to be about 15 to 16 inches tall, and your sticks stand in it vertically. And so that's very little wood, whereas your conventional wood stove is a much larger box, and you could probably fit 5 to 8 times more than that at one time. So that's going to explain a lot of the volume of the smoke that goes out of a conventional wood stove. All right, so the bottom line is that, another point is in here, rocket mass heaters have an actual fire for much less time. And I'm going to speculate about a fifth of the time. And the mass will give off heat for days so people continue to feel warm long after the fire's gone out. So then all the time that there's no fire burning, then there's no exhaust coming out. So a conventional wood stove puts a large volume of high heat out the chimney for a long time. A rocket mass heater puts a small amount of low heat out the exhaust for much less time. More heat stays in the house. Okay. Oh, yeah. Evidence that anybody can buy a lab coat. I own a lab coat because I bought it on the internet. Okay. So now let's take on these exact quotes, these exact words. Used well, a rocket mass heater can be more efficient than a modern wood stove, but only by 10% at most, in my opinion. And I'm glad she said in my opinion. That's good engineering right there, is to be able to qualify your statement. My response, the phrase 75% efficient, so when that's written on the marketing material, it gives you the impression that there's only 25% play space left. This claim that we make, 1/10 of wood, makes people think that I'm claiming that the stove is 750% efficient, and 750% is much larger than 100%, and 100% is the maximum. I think in her comments, she also said Wheaton doesn't understand what 100% means. And so I do understand what 100% means. So the phrase in her statement, used well, is the catch. An excellent operator of a conventional wood stove will probably get 35% efficiency out of a 75% efficient wood stove. But where we really make big progress is most of your wood burners. A lot of them are only getting 3% to 12% efficiency out of their 75% efficient wood stove. And so that's where we do especially well. I think a lot of the people that are already an excellent operator and they're doing amazing things with their conventional wood stove, when they switch to a rocket mass heater, they're more on the end of the spectrum, where it's like they're now heating their home with 1/5 the wood. Whereas the people of a more regular group, a more normal group, they're going to be closer to 1/10 the wood. And when we're talking about this, I mean, it's like an 80% reduction in the amount of wood you use versus a 90% reduction. So it's really not all that different. Okay, then she says something about knowledge of thermodynamics and the fundamentals of physics. And I just think that we're not really talking about, when we talk about this 75% efficient, that's more about marketing, really. And politics of and regulation rules about, like, what are the rules about when you say 75% efficient, what does that mean? So, and then beyond that, it's just some basic simple math and knowledge of how the tests are done really has little to do with knowledge of thermodynamics or the fundamentals of physics. And I think when she's saying fundamentals of physics, I think what she's trying to say is the thing about how between 75% and 100%, you really only got 25% to play with. I think that's what she's saying is fundamentals of physics, which I don't think is fundamentals of physics. I think that's fundamentals of math. Oh, I'm an engineer who consults on building efficiency. Me too. So I think she's properly regurgitating the information that she was told to regurgitate. And that information that she's working from was created without knowledge of a rocket mass heater. And so I think that that's where a lot of her frustration is coming from. She's passing on a message that she was told to pass on, and she's sticking to it, and she's got great loyalty to her company. I'm bringing along some information that conflicts with it. And if we go back to the Wheaton Eco scale, she's functioning at level one. We're functioning at level six. Of course, our stuff looks kind of nuts to her. All right. Okay. Now, here's some other things that she said that I want to address, because these are just these kinds of questions. All these questions come up all the time. So I am picking on this one person. But it's not the things that she's saying. It's not the first time that they've been said. And in fact, here's some more stuff that she said in that same post, that same thing that she wrote, that I'm going to continue to address. A rocket mass heater won't burn properly unless you use small pieces of dry wood. A wood stove will burn, but not well on the whole, damp logs. There could be major efficiency improvements if the homeowner went from firing a wood stove incorrectly to firing a rocket mass heater correctly. I would say that there's a lot of truth to this, but there are still some things I need to unravel. I've used wet and green wood in both systems, so both of them suffer from that. But you can use green wood and wet wood in a rocket mass heater. It sucks, just like it sucks in a conventional wood stove. The wood feed for a J-tube system is small, so you'll have to use smaller wood. Now, I prefer to keep mine wrist size or smaller. Ernie, once he gets the fire going, he likes to get a block of wood that will just barely fit into the wood feed, just one huge chunk. All right, but setting all of that aside, here's a very, very important thing in the world of rocket mass heaters: the batch box system. So Peter Vandenberg has been doing amazing things with these batch box systems. There's upsides and downsides to the batch box, but as you can see, that's a pretty big box. You could put a lot of wood in there. Basically, you can make these batch boxes hold more wood than what you hold in a conventional wood stove. So a lot of the concerns being expressed are now eliminated by the size of the wood. I prefer a J-tube style. I mean, when Peter first built this system that we're looking at a picture of right here, it was amazing, and there was oohing and aahing, and I was kind of thinking, like, this changes everything. And now that we have three batch box systems here, and I've had the opportunity to use them and deal with issues around them and stuff, I got to say, I'm going to continue to advocate the J-tube for now. And I think that the batch box is great if you got a lot of money. And that's, I think the batch box is better if you're willing to take the time, do some welding. I mean, it's the door. You got to deal with the door. Oh, here we are. So we can see that same system. Now it's got a door mounted on it. And it's like, that this door is much better than, I see my hand there, I'm holding what was used for the door before, which was a terrible, it was like, oh, we'll just build this for like a couple of days until the metal thing gets built. But it was years until the metal thing got built. It was a mess. Still, even with the steel door, not a perfect system. I think that there's still improvements that could be done, although large advantages to having a large, I mean, basically you burn a lot of wood really, really fast. And so then you get all the heat stored right away and you're not having to refill your little J-tube every 20 minutes for 2 hours. But it's like going from a conventional wood stove to a J-tube system, you burn so much less wood and you have to futz with the fire so much less. It's just a joy. And then going from a J-tube to a batch box system, it's like you cut it by a factor of three again. And so it is the ultimate in many ways. And I still like the J-tube better. All right. So here's the general outline of a J-tube system. You can see where it says fuel feed. And your sticks go in here. And your sticks will all remain vertical. Do not try to get your sticks to be horizontal down in the burn tunnel. That's not how this works. Your sticks stay vertical. And then the bottom of the sticks burns. And then the fire goes sideways and then up the heat riser. And then the barrel collects the heat and puts the heat out into the room. And then the exhaust is collected in the manifold and sent through the ducting, which goes through the mass. This is another thing that she has said. There is no way that a house with a significant hole in the wall would be more efficient than one without one. And the claim is misleading and false. I kind of feel like anytime anybody points at me and calls me a liar, I want to just state that it's some sort of empirical fact that I don't even have to say anything. And I want you all to just know that I'm pointing back at them and calling them a liar. It's a reflective state. All right. So the claim is misleading and false. Okay. Let's work with that. So this is based on a story that I heard in 2009. So her stuff about a hole in the wall is from something that I have attempted to explain several times. And the story is basically, I heard it from, it was Ernie and Erica and Ianto and Kiko, and I can't remember who else was there, but we had like five in 2009 when I knew nothing about rocket mass heaters and I was just learning them. There were five instructors there. It was an awesome experience for me. But they were all pointing out to me how there was this building in Sweden, and there is a gap along the roof of about 3 or 4 inches to the outside, and it's 20 below outside, and they're all sitting inside, and they're all perfectly warm. And so it's like, how can that be? And so it's not that I'm trying to say that this – that having a hole in the wall is more efficient than not having a hole in the wall. What I am trying to say is that radiant heat and conductive heat are far more efficient than convective heat. Now, convective heat is the most common. Convective heat is where you heat the air and then the air heats you. But that's the least efficient form of heat. And at the same time, it's how most systems are designed. So if you're using convective heat and you got a big hole in the wall, convective heat is going to really, really suck. But if you're using, say, conductive heat and you got a big hole in the wall, you might not even notice. It might make no difference if there's a hole in the wall. You'll still feel just as comfortable. Yes, it's true. You might possibly feel more comfortable, but it's like, you might feel more comfortable if there is no hole in the wall. Like, you won't require as much fuel. But the amount of fuel to make a person feel comfortable using conductive heat is going to be much less than the amount of fuel. Okay, let me say this one more time. I'm screwing it all up. The amount of fuel that you would use using conductive heat with a hole in the wall is far, far less than the amount of fuel you'll need if you use convective heat and there is no hole in the wall. So I'm glad to be, on her standards, a liar. However, I think that this knowledge of different kinds of heat and which is more efficient, and this is an important thing to know and to work with. And rocket mass heaters do work a lot with this. All right. But the key is that I know that there's a lot of people that are like being confused in this space. So we did an experiment. We set up a rocket mass heater in a teepee. And so the teepee has a big gap all along the bottom edge so that air can get in. And of course, there's a big gap at the top. There's a big opening at the top for air to pass out. I mean, the design of the teepee is effectively a kind of chimney itself. You have the The idea is you'd have a fire in the middle of the teepee and you sit in a circle around it, Indian style. And then the air comes in behind you and then goes to the fire and then goes up. And you better be sitting on the ground because there's this big cloud of smoke just above your head when you're sitting on the ground. So you probably don't want to stand up. But the key is that this is not insulated. It's not insulated at all. And yet people stayed warm. And it has to do with the three kinds of heat. And this is a lovely graphic. Alexander Ojeda made this for me. So convective heat, where you heat the air heats you. Radiant heat is like the sun. There's a heat source. And whichever part of you is facing the heat source feels warm. The part that's not facing the heat source does not feel warm. And then there's conductive heat, where you're touching a warm thing, and that's warming you. That's the most conductive is the most efficient. Convective is the least efficient. On DVD one, half of the DVD is about the TP project. So DVD one has, of this new four DVD set that we have, DIY Rocket Mass Heaters, the first half of DVD one is about heating a log structure, a very basic Cobb-style rocket mass heater. And the second half of the DVD is about the Cobb-style rocket mass heater, the teepee, and basically the experiment and how warm the people felt. So this is Emily and Tony. They were our guinea pigs a couple of years ago, the very first year that we were here on Wheaton Labs. And we built this, and they stayed the winter in here. They have recently gotten married. I want to pretend that somehow I helped, but I didn't. The key is that on one night it got to be 26 degrees below zero, and they got up in the morning. They put on their day clothes. They took off their night clothes, put on their day clothes, and they didn't know how cold it was until they got outside. So then I grilled them endlessly with questions about their experience, because, you know, all of this was all for that one morning when they got up, that minute of time. What did it feel like? What did it feel like while you're, you know, getting up and you're moving, you're taking off your night clothes and you're getting into your day clothes? How warm or cold did it feel? And they said it felt like about 50 degrees. And it's 26 below outside, uninsulated structure, and the fire has been out for more than 8 hours. So I think that this experiment was a massive success. In the video, DVD one, then I think this is a clip right out of it. And during the video, when the video was taken for the part of the winter shot, I think it was actually 4 below while they took the video. So it wasn't that night when it was 26 below, but it's still an incredibly cold night. I think these are more clips from the video, from DVD one. All right, here's another one. Paul claimed that with a rocket mass heater, you could heat your house with the twigs that fell in your yard. Even if we accept that we only need 1/8 the amount of wood, as with a wood stove, an efficient house in a cold climate will need 3 to 4 cords of wood. A cord is this big. That's a lot of twigs and much more than fall in my front yard. Okay, so I'm not sure, but I think she's trying to say that 4 cords of wood as twigs is a lot more wood than falls in her yard. But she missed the step where I'm saying that you only need 1/2 cord of wood for that particular house. And I think that a lot of people are going to get that little bit of wood that you know, the twigs and branches from their front yard that naturally fall off the trees. Like I think they can probably get maybe even all of the wood that they need from their front yard, if it's only 1/2 cord of wood, and that's what I'm claiming. But her math up there, I think, is still stuck on, like, you're not doing the 1/8, which she mentions right there. I think she left out that bit of math stuff. She says, I have some concerns about safety. The barrel gets very hot. A conventional wood stove also gets hot. And so I think, in fact, I think that the barrel, I mean, we're going to try to hold the heat in for a while. And then when the heat hits the top of the barrel and then it starts coming down the sides, I think that the sides of the barrel end up being not as hot as a conventional wood stove. Part of that is because the amount of fuel we burn at one time with a J-tube rocket mass heater is so much less wood. But and on top of that, most of the heat is given off of the top and then the sides, and then the rest of it we shoot through the mass. When you touch the mass, you don't get burned. But you could get burned touching the barrel. In fact, some people use the top of the barrel for cooking, although that's, you know, not a great thing because the fire doesn't burn that long and then you don't have a fire for cooking. But it's like, okay, so conventional wood stove, you could burn yourself there too. Let's see. And then, of course, there's the whole thing where, like, the fire isn't burning nearly as often as it is with a conventional wood stove. So you have far more safety. So in this thing, I spell out, like, well, if you run a conventional wood stove 10 hours, you might run a rocket mass heater about 2 hours. And then so for those other 8 hours that you're not burning it, there's no way you can get burned. So maybe you can say that a rocket mass heater is 80% safer than a conventional wood stove. Here's some stuff that's come up over the years. There's something about Paul needs to explain this photo. Okay. Which photo? I don't know.
The last photo with the woman sitting on the stove.
Okay. All right. that's ripe for humor, which I'm sure I could easily offend all of you. So I'm going to walk past that. Look at how classy I am walking past that, fighting my nature. So I grabbed these slides from a different presentation I did that I put together a couple of weeks ago. And so a guy, Rick English, came up with a bunch of these images. I think that these are old images that are like they're now in the public domain because they're so old. And so Rick English grabbed a bunch of images and filled out the slide deck with these images that we could use for a conventional wood stove.
I think that's an old advertising picture.
Oh, advertising what exactly?
Well, they're advertising the stove, of course.
Oh, the stove. Oh, okay.
This is why you would want to buy this stove for your wife.
She'll like it this much. I don't. Is she getting burned up there? All right. Okay. Back to this. This is skepticism that I've collected from other people. I wrote these based on how I've heard these kinds of things so many times. Everybody in the house will die from carbon monoxide poisoning. Think of the children. Okay. Oh, Jesus goes on. This one's probably the number one thing that people bring up. And in the end, I figured out what the root of it is. People are confused between what is a rocket stove and what is a rocket mass heater. Now, in the past, we've called a rocket mass heater a rocket stove mass heater because the design is, you know, done by Ianto Evans, who is the inventor of the rocket stove. And so he basically, like, you know, did the rocket stove thing over in Africa. And then he comes back here to the United States and it's like, oh, they're having all these energy problems. I'm going to use this technology to solve all the energy problems here in the United States. So he used the technology in the rocket mass heater. But the thing is that a rocket stove, by the standards of most people at this time, is like used for cooking when you're camping. And so people will buy a rocket stove and you put your sticks in it and it burns the sticks. And then the exhaust goes, if you were to bring this camp stove into the house, then it would put all of the smoke-ish stuff, the exhaust-ish stuff into the room that you're in. And so that's where people are thinking like, oh, carbon monoxide poisoning. But a rocket mass heater, the exhaust is vented outside. So there's no more carbon monoxide in a house than there would be. In fact, you even go so far as to say there would be 80% less or 90% less danger of carbon monoxide poisoning in your home with a rocket mass heater than with a conventional wood stove. And in fact, I'm kind of curious. I would think that there's probably even less than that when you compare any wood stove to natural gas, because a lot of people have been poisoned with carbon monoxide poisoning from a natural gas system. And it's kind of gotten to be almost epidemic. I mean, I know of many people who've been poisoned. And I think the great thing about a rocket mass heater or a conventional wood stove is that, A, the fuel is so much easier to find. You can walk outside and like, look, there's a stick. I could take it home and love it and nurture it, and someday it will heat my home. But then you can't go wandering around outside and find like bits of natural gas. Like, oh, there goes some natural gas. Quick, chase it down. And the same thing goes for electricity. I don't see electricity where I can just go out and pick some up and bring it home. And so then the bits of wood that you bring home, you put them in a pile and they just sit there. They don't poison anybody. They don't make rude gestures. They don't explode. Nothing like that. I mean, there is fire danger, but I mean, like, it's minimal when compared to some, like, natural gas. I know that there have been explosions that have, like, blown up four houses. So, I think that, okay, so there's how I address that bit of the carbon monoxide thing. It's this is a rocket mass heater, not a rocket stove. And I'm hoping that we're going to, I'm trying to work harder at separating the two, because they've clearly divided and gone in two different directions. And so we got to reduce skepticism. This look does not go with my couch or my drapes or my spouse. It doesn't match her fingernails. I don't know. But it's some people are not feeling it for the aesthetic. And first of all, we start with the barrel. And so here we have a picture where it is a fabricated barrel. So these guys went to some place where it's, you know, they do a lot of welding and stuff. And they said, hey, we want you to make something that's a cylinder with a cap on one end and open on the other end. So they basically got this lovely barrel substitute for their rocket mass heater. In this picture, which is just a clip out of, I think, DVD 2 out of the new 4DVD set, on the left, you can see the barrel. It's a stainless steel barrel. I think it's cool looking. In fact, you know, after it's been used a lot, it kind of starts to blue in some spots. It gets a really cool color to it. And notice that the rest of the aesthetic, so it's kind of like, this is what we call a pebble style rocket mass heater, and so instead of it being a cob bench, it's a wood box filled with pea gravel, and in this case, topped with granite. It's a different aesthetic. And when you do cob, I mean, cob is like it's the sculptor's dream. I've seen some exceptionally amazingly beautiful stuff done with cob. But granted, again, like this is going to be something that a lot of people are going to be like, that it doesn't match the drapes in my house or something. This one, I can't help but think that almost anybody would love to have this one in their home. I think this one's exceptionally beautiful. The guy that built this was at the 2012 event for the first 4DV set. Again, a stainless steel barrel. You know, some more really pretty looks. At least I think they're pretty. Here's probably one of the most famous ones. This comes from a DVD that was recorded by Kaylin Kennett, and it was also built by Ernie and Erica. It's a single standalone DVD that's available on Amazon. Okay. A lot of people get the feeling that the barrel will rust. They're very concerned about it. And I think most of it has to do with, like, I think back in the 70s, Mother Earth News ran an article about this style of a double barrel wood stove. And what happens is that with this particular style of wood stove, the barrels do tend to start, like, rusting holes through in about 3 months. And so then those gases that are involved in the combustion process start to leak out. And it's like, if you've spent a bunch of time building this wood stove, you're probably not going to rebuild it every 3 months. And so they get more and more holes to the point that you just can't use them. The barrels rust out really fast. But for a rocket mass heater, we have no record of the process of using this rocket mass heater causing rust. We've put barrels in place that had rust on them, or the outside of the barrel would start to rust because water, you know. But the inside tends to stay very, very clean because it's a very low oxygen environment. And so, you know, it's oxidation. It requires oxygen in order to rust, and there's very little of it. So there's a rocket mass heater in the rainforest of Oregon that has used the exact same barrel for 20 years. And you got to keep in mind, rocket mass heaters are relatively new technology. And in fact, that particular one, I think, might be the oldest one that's still around that we know of. So we ought to watch that barrel to see how long it takes until it rusts through. But it's not showing any sign of giving up to rust. Okay, so I got to point out, before I get all the hate mail, the image on the right was a joke put together by four women. No men involved. And they just thought they were being funny. So, all right. Actual problems. Let's talk about real problems. And these are rarely ever brought up, but I think they're pretty obvious. Heavy and takes up space. So a rocket mass heater is kind of big. I mean, it needs the mass. If you're going to be on a cement pad or directly on the ground or a cob floor or something like that, you're in great shape. But if you're going to be on a wooden floor, like the second floor of a building, or if you're in a double wide, which is where I'm sitting at the moment, then it's not a cement pad. And so you've got to shore up the floor from underneath to be able to handle the extra weight. Limited view of the flames. A lot of people want to get a wood stove where they can see the fire. And I'm going to show you a picture in a little while where you can see the fire. And there have been rocket mass heaters built where there is glass involved and you can see the fire really great. And it's very exciting. But it violates one of the things that you're trying to do with the rocket mass heater, which is to have the fire burn in an insulated space. Too much heat escapes through that glass, which makes it beautiful for you. But at the same time, the fire doesn't really get hot enough to do all the things that we want it to do. So limited view of the flames. Building codes and insurance. Portland's got stuff in their building codes. There's a lot of other cities, a lot of other places that are now working rocket mass heaters in their building codes. It's a very recent thing. They've always been legal outdoors everywhere. So if you want to do a butt warmer outdoors for your friends, that's always legal. Insurance companies are even starting to come around. And then, of course, there's this thing where a lot of people just believe that they're going to build it and the laws will catch up later. And some people want to be trailblazers in their community. And so I know of a lot of people that are building them in areas. And frankly, this is how regulation works. Is that you gotta, in order for regulation to change and upgrade, there has to be somebody with the courage to break the law. And I've got a podcast made with Art Ludwig, who's the author of the Greywater books. And the legislators came to his house to see his illegal setup. And now they have him rewriting those laws for the state of California. So somebody's got to blaze this trail. And fortunately, there are a lot of people with courage. And I think, you know, right now, I think that there's hundreds of thousands of these in existence. I don't think it's going to be too much longer before we hit the 1 million mark. Interest has been growing exponentially. Actual problem is Gilligan's. The way that you start a fire in a rocket mass heater is different than in a conventional wood stove. When you think about it, you need to have the sideways burn, not a fire where the smoke's going straight up and into your face. So you need to do it right. And so Gilligans are what we refer to people here as, that they show up, they're excited to help, they're anxious to help, they're full of energy, they're full of ideas, and it's like, oh, it's cold in here, I'll start a fire. And so we're having problems with them not doing it correctly, not learning how to do it correctly first, that kind of thing. It's a different way of using it. It's not that different, but it's different enough. Here you can see the fire burning sideways. That's Erica Wisner. She has that brand new book out for building the Rocket Mass Heater Builder's Guide. Just came out, I think, in July. Excellent book. Oh, we've been needing this book for a long time. But this particular fire has two windows to be able to see the flames. Gilligan. Upsides. Very clean, 1/100 of the smoke. If you're currently heating with electric heat and you switch to a rocket mass heater, it's as you will reduce your carbon footprint the same as if you just parked 7 cars. So I know when we talk about greenhouse gases and carbon dioxide, and you know, I think we just hit 400 parts per million for carbon. And it's like, you know, we're to the point where there's people very concerned that we can't go back and, you know, all the climate change stuff. But switching from electric heat to a rocket mass heater does more to solve the carbon problem, the carbon dioxide problem, than parking 7 cars. They're cheap to build. I've heard of people building them for like $20. Like, they scavenge materials for a year, and then they built the whole rocket mass heater, beautiful rocket mass heater, for $20. But most people don't scavenge, and they end up spending $400 to $600 in materials. Very cheap to run. I think a lot of people are switching from natural gas heat and spending something on the order of $1,500 a year to a rocket mass heater, where they are heating their home with just the twigs that act off trees. So it costs nothing to run every year. But if you buy firewood, you can do that. You can buy regular cordwood and bring it in, and that'll work great. And around here, it's generally about 200. And for my house, we think that we use about a half a cord a year. So $100 a year in wood. And you don't even have to, like, pick the sticks up and bring them in the house. Which, you know, we did stack the wood, so that took some effort. But, keeps your home cooler in the summer. And this is something that was really delicious this year, that we've got our rocket mass heater all done in the house, is that when it gets really hot outside, the rocket mass heater was effectively cooled through the evening. And so technically it absorbed heat. It lost its heat to the evening, and then in the daytime, it absorbed heat from the warm interior of the house, and so it kept the interior very cool. And this has been something we've heard from a lot of rocket mass heater owners, that it helps to keep your home much cooler during the summertime. A lot of people love the luxury that you get from a heated floor. So when you stand on a heated floor, walk around a heated floor, it just feels so nice. And if you sit on a rocket mass heater when it's warm, that is some first-class luxury right there. That is some luxury that your natural gas heater does not give you. It's very nice. A lot of natural material. I mean, the cob style is cob is sand and clay, and sometimes straw. So lots and lots of natural materials being used in building a rocket mass heater. Depending on what you want to do for certain points, we are using some other materials. But, you know, they can, you can get to the point where the entire thing is very, very natural. When you run it, you get quick heat from the barrel, slow heat from the mass. A lot of times you go, I know that throughout the winter, I typically go 2 days between building a fire. And I live in Montana. So this is, so I'll be in January in Montana, and I'll have a fire every other day because the mass will stay warm and the house stays warm. And another luxuriant upside compared to a conventional wood heat is that with conventional wood heat, in the morning, nobody wants to get out of bed to start the fire because it's cold. It's gotten so cold in the house. But with a rocket mass heater in the morning, it's warm. It's only like if you go to bed and it's 75 in the house, you'll get up in the morning and it'll be 72. So it's very it keeps the house very warm by giving off that heat from the mass. That looks like up. Here's a great example. This is how give you an idea how clean it is. So this is a video that I have up on YouTube, and the video is only like 2 minutes long. You can go watch it, but you can see that there's an active fire in this rocket mass heater. This is a demonstration I did in 2010. And so we build this thing in an hour and 10 minutes, put a fire to it, and the fire is actively going, and the woman puts her face into the exhaust, and you'll notice that the heat is not burning away the flesh on her face because the exhaust is like about 70. And at the same time, the words that she speaks are critically important. She smells the exhaust. She smells deeply. And she says, I can smell the smoke smell, but there is no smoke. Now, if you did this with a conventional wood stove, of course, it would just be a cloud of smoke. And there's no way she'd be able to put her face that close to it. This is a clip from the Kickstarter stuff for our new 4DVD set. But this is to give you an idea of the amount of carbon dioxide that's put out. So natural gas puts out far less carbon dioxide than electric heat. And then, of course, we're talking about the electricity from the power plants. And a wood stove puts out much less carbon dioxide than that. And, of course, a rocket mass heater is a tenth of whatever a wood stove is. Then there's the whole thing about the cost. And so then this graph is assuming that you're buying your firewood. So a wood stove is just a little bit less than natural gas, which is a lot less than electric heat. But a rocket mass heater is going to be much, much less than a conventional wood stove. This is the rocket mass heater that was it's featured in DVD 1 as the first half of DVD 1. It's also the star of Ernie and Erica's new book. And when we built this, we wanted to build the most basic, simple rocket mass heater. And the reason is that a lot of times people will build these beautiful rocket mass heaters, and then if you try to, you know, use that as a how-to, it's difficult for people to understand which parts are the essential parts and which parts are the optional parts. So this one's very basic. So it's like these steps were all the required steps. Here's all the free stuff that we have available about rocket mass heaters. And then, of course, at the very bottom, there's a link to get to the DVDs. And that's it. That's the end of my presentation.
Awesome.
How long did I go? Did I go too long?
No, never can go too long with Paul Wheaton. Let's see. We went an hour and 13 minutes.
Ah, damn. I was hoping to be faster than that.
Well, you know what? We kind of BS'd around in the beginning, so it's probably about an hour. But awesome presentation. I enjoyed it a lot. How about you guys?
How do they show? Oh, I guess they type in the little typey thing.
Yeah. Chat. Type in the typey thing. Or raise your hand. We got some raised hands. All right.
Somebody had to leave.
Yeah, but that's okay. We're recording this, so if you had to leave, and or if you want to share this with your friends later, they can watch the recorded version. Started 9 minutes late. Wow, Lance was keeping track.
Okay. Oh, now this, so Trent doesn't have questions.
All right. Well, let's leave that screen up there for a little bit. Guys, we have questions that we're going to go through. We have a Q&A session. And so...
A lot of nudity the first 7 minutes.
Of course. Like I said.
Hey, just so we can please you.
At least we weren't naked.
Actually, I've got my layer of wool on here. Since I do have a rocket mass heater, it's plenty warm in here. And I got sun coming in my south-facing window, warming up this room. Awesome. And it's a very cold day here in Montana. And yet, we got no fire burning, but it's plenty warm in here.
All right, guys, what we're going to do is I have a quick poll for you. If you could go through that poll, just answer the questions. I think there's like 6 or 7 questions. Then we'll jump into the Q&A. And so, Paul, now is the time. If you need to go stuff your face with food or get some water or anything like that, we'll spend about 5 minutes with this poll, and then we'll jump into the Q&A.
I'm gonna stare at the chat stuff.
All right. So there's the poll, guys. It's 8 questions. I apologize. 8 questions. One of the questions on there is about PETV. So PETV currently is just this show because we just launched PETV earlier this year. And we want to fill it with more shows. And one of those show ideas is to have me and Paul kind of just bullshitting about permaculture stuff that's going on. And so we're interested in if you guys would enjoy that. Me and Paul get along really well, and I think we play off each other pretty well. So I think it would be an enjoyable show. So we'd like to know what you think about that idea. And I'm also kind of looking for ideas for show names. So we've thrown around bits and bobs, permaculture bits and bobs, or maybe permaculture BS. Whatever you got, we're up for ideas. I'm looking at chat while you guys fill out that form or the poll. Thank you for the feedback, guys. Some people want a full course. Awesome. A lot of you guys have already registered for upcoming presentations. You can do that at tv.permethos.com. Awesome. Glad to see that. We're almost at the end of season 2 of PETV presentations. At the end of season 1. Season 2 will start January, I believe. And then that show, if we do it with me and Paul, will probably start January or February. Oh,
there,
yeah,
YouTube questions. I did quickie answers.
Yeah, thank you.
But I think some of those we can expand on a bit.
Yeah, and those are private, so people don't know what those questions were if you want to talk about them. Let's just start with that. Looks like almost everybody's filled out the poll. But go ahead, and if you want to just talk about those questions you were just answering in private chat, go ahead and do that.
Okay, so... somebody mentioned something about external air intake. And the idea of an external air intake is great if the way that you want to heat your home is with convective heat, where you heat the air. But we've got a system. So if you watch the 4DVD set, I actually go into a lot of detail about this because we have an experimental system that we set up. We talk about it in DVD 2. And one of the options that were added to it, and I saw that Ernie and Erica documented this in their book, was an external air intake. And so I found that – so I had this option to use this external air intake as much as I wanted to. And in the end, it was kind of like, I don't want to. It's – the thing is that we don't burn a fire very often. And then the one thing is that if you have the interior air intake, it kind of sucks the stale, stagnant air out of the room and takes it outside. So all your old BO and farts and whatever else all gets sucked outside. And then the air inside is nice and fresh and lovely. And then you've got this mass heating you and heating the air and heating everything from there with all this lovely fresh air, and it's nice. The thing that, you know, the reason why people want to use external air intakes is the idea that you're going to burn cold air instead of burning the already warm air in the house. And so there's a couple of issues with that. One is that you want to try to get things inside your rocket mass heater to be as hot as you can. Better to start with the warmer air than the colder air. So, you know that's going to help you get it to be warmer faster and to have a more efficient burn and a cleaner burn. the other thing is that with a rocket mass heater, we're doing a lot with radiant heat, and where we heat things in the room, and then those things then radiate heat back out to us, as well as using some convective heat, especially as the mass later heats and stuff. So I just kind of feel like for a lot of my aspect on permaculture, a lot of people are like, I'm going to save the world by sacrificing something. Like vegans, I think that they're doing a lot. They believe that they're doing a lot. And they're going to sacrifice bacon for a better world for everybody. And I think that's a very noble path. I prefer to try to explore the parts of permaculture that are going to be like, how can we make the world a better place while simultaneously having a more luxuriant life? And from the aspect or the angle of having a more luxuriant life, I liked using the air from inside better than from outside. And I felt that I wasn't gaining anything pulling it from outside. I mean, technically, I know mathematically I was gaining something, but I prefer this other way. And if it cost me an extra stick of wood, I'm okay with it. I don't think it did, though. When I'm in the end, I think it's going to be a bit of a wash. And I like the idea of the better air exchange. Huh? Is that a good answer? Huh?
Good answer. All right. For those that join in late, the Q&A button is where you want to ask questions. We got 15 questions to go through right now. But if we can get through all those, go ahead and ask now and add them to the Q&A, and we'll go through those. So, Paul, do you want – I think it works best if I just read these questions instead of picking the person out and promoting them so they can video question and ask stuff. Maybe on the show we'll do a live kind of Q&A like that. But I'm going to go through the questions.
All right.
So first question comes from Mitchell, Mitchell Cutler. And Mitchell asks, can you do a short out for a shout out for Marjorie at the Grow Network for her Mother Earth online summit coming up on the 31st? What's that all about?
Oh, okay. So I've put together, I spent like a day and a half, 2 days putting together a presentation for Marjorie, and she had a very specific format. So of the presentation I just gave, I stole some of the things I put together for Marjorie and put them in here. And I think the thing I did for Marjorie is 35 minutes long, but I did an exact script. And I know that there's more information in Marjorie's thing that I did for her. So Marjorie's got an event coming up. I think it's at the end of this month, where it's a free thing, and she's going to have like 45 different people. I know Joel Salatin's one, and I think Justin Rhodes is another one. He's been doing a lot with permaculture chickens, and so it's going to be a mega webinar-y kind of a thing.
Awesome.
Does that help paint a picture?
Yeah. Where, what's the website for that?
That's a great question. I always just search for Marjorie Wildcraft, and then I get to her stuff, and there's
It's homegrownfoodsummit.com. That or if you can Marjorie Wildcraft.com, it redirects you to homegrownfoodsummit.com. All right.
Next question, please.
Next question. Can you make a Rocket Math's pizza oven from Mitchell?
I'm going to say yes, because we've got, during the Innovators event, so the DVD 4 of the new set is from the 2015 Innovators event, and as part of that, Tim Barker built a 3-in-1 thing that it was a rocket griddle, oven, and water heater. And we have used that to make many pizzas. And so we've had a lot of pizzas out of that. So that's a rocket oven for pizzas. Wow, much cool. Cleaner, much less fuel than using like a cob oven.
And you could probably get away with that from the legal standpoint if you said it's pizza oven, right?
Well, if it's outdoors, you know, you can get away with it. Yeah. Absolutely, entirely, easy peasy, get away with it. I think another thing is that for a conventional cob oven, now there's also the double chamber cob oven, which Ernie has made. I got a video of him making it, or a video of him using it, and he's got plans for it available. But with a conventional cob oven, they put out a lot of smoke, just pouring the smoke out. So I would think that if you're going to do that, then you might get neighbors maybe calling the fire department, if not the Department of Making You Sad, to say, "You're making smoke, man." And so with the double chamber cob oven, or with the, you know, any of the rocket stuff, there's like really no smoke. So I think there's a great story from Ernie and Erica. They had a neighbor who I refer to as Mrs. Kravitz. And I think only a few people watching now probably know the reference. So it's a very old television show. Had a woman living across the street who was always peeking out the curtains and spying, you know, and then would, like, you know, report anything. So Ernie Bewitched, that's exactly it. So there's so Ernie and Erica built a rocket mass heater, and they had a Mrs. Kravitz across the street who was always complaining about everything and always, you know, calling the Department of Making You Sad. But she never once called about the rocket mass heater because she never saw any smoke. And so she never saw anything to report. So, in fact, I think, you know, my understanding is, and I heard a rumor once, and this could be crazy, that there was this herb that was against the law. I think it's called marijuana. And people would still partake of this herb, even though it was against the law. And I don't know why. It's against the law. And now they had their reasons, whatever they were. I'm sure they were noble reasons. And now we've got something where it's like, this can save you a couple $1,000s a year by using this heat. And it's got this lower carbon footprint that, you know, might be the equivalent of parking 7 cars. So there's a lot of people that are like, I'd rather put that $1,500 into pizzas than give it to the power company. And other people that have the noble goal of, like, you know, less carbon in the atmosphere, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's reasons. People have their reasons. And so I've heard a rumor that there are some people, because of reasons, that they've decided to take the risk. And that actually, like, if they get busted, they believe that what could happen is of less risk than that marijuana thing.
I got to say, it's a good thing that rocket mass heaters are not in competition with the pharmaceutical industry. There's no lobbying against it.
Right. It's only in competition with big oil.
Yeah.
Big all energy. Right. That's all. Nothing to see here. Move along.
All right. Next question is from Mike Cooley. Mike asks, could you please expand on the comment you made about no metal in the riser?
Yeah, don't do that. I'm glad we had this chat. All right. So, I mean, we're shooting for temperatures of beyond 3,000 degrees. That's what we want. And we're seeing those temperatures now. I mean, it's only been in the last 4 years that we've been seeing these temperatures of over 3,000 degrees. Steel, like metal, well, any metal, you pick your favorite metal, put that inside of there, it melts, it turns to liquid at 2,600 degrees. So I think that's kind of the end of the story, right? I mean, it's going to not stay put.
Yeah, building a forge.
So don't do that. Don't put that there. Yeah. Nope. Metal on the outside of the riser is fine, because once the heat comes up the middle of the riser and hits the top of the barrel, I mean, it cools really fast, which is where it's giving off heat on the outside of the barrel, passes right through the barrel. So it's like outside of the riser, metal is fine, no problem.
So is that why we see on those pictures the barrel isn't completely covered in cob? The top half is always uncovered?
You need it to cool. So you want to not cover it with cob. Basically, it's the secondary thermosiphon is when you've got like this large warm air at the top and you get this smaller, cooler air at the bottom. It's forcing it down. So the riser forced the air up as it was getting hotter. And then the barrel is like kind of sucking and pushing down. And so it's like this is a double pump thermocycle.
So when they're building these, they got the barrel, are most of them just completely uncovered at first, and then you kind of test it to see how it works and maybe cover more and more of it as you test to see what's more efficient?
I would cover as little of the barrel as possible.
Okay.
You know, I mean, there have been systems that I've seen where they've extended the height of the barrel and then they had pretty much no heat at all going into the bench, which is, you know, I think that for a wood shop that you only used on weekends, that might not be a bad way to go.
Right.
Because what's the point of heating it on Monday and Tuesday when you're not there? Better to just put the heat right into the room right away. Usually the barrel is, you know, I mean, the designs, because you need the riser to be almost exactly 48 inches tall. And so then the barrel is already kind of up a ways in order to bring the exhaust gases back down. And just to have the cob right where you seal the barrel turns out to be just about right. But I've seen people where they've like done things to attach two barrels and have something taller. So like down in our shop with the batch box system, we've got an extra barrel extending the first barrel because we want to get as much heat out of the system as we can and we don't care about what goes into the bench.
Okay. All right. Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah. Next question from Brian Wood. Brian asks, what the heck is punky wood? What are you talking about? Is that non-aged full of sap wood or what?
I'm talking about your mother, Mr. Wood. So, I don't know your mom. Sorry, I don't know why I said that. Punky wood is going to be wood that's kind of rotten. It's like you could rip it apart with your hands. It's you know, it's very lightweight. It burns really fast. It's almost like paper, but it doesn't have a lot of BTUs in it. Punky, old. You could stick your fingers into it. Smash!
All right.
Did that answer your question?
That answers it. Next question is from Jamie Black. Jamie says, I live in an area with a lot of pine. Traditional wood burning stoves are a headache because of all the soot burning and collecting in the chimney. Is this an issue with a rocket stove?
Okay, run the question by me one more time.
I live in an area with a lot of pine.
Okay.
Traditional wood-burning stoves were a headache because of all the soot that's been burning and collecting in the chimney. Is this an issue that Rocket Mass has?
We still have soot because, I mean, like here where I'm at, we're using conifer wood also. And there's still soot. We don't have any creosote. We do still have ash. We have virtually no smoke, but there is still soot. But it's like, I don't know. I open up a system and I'll see soot in it, but I've never seen enough soot to be like, and I better clean that out. I mean, I cleaned out ash, but I haven't ever needed to clean out soot, but it is there. I do see it inside the systems. So there have been some things that have either, I'm not sure if I could say that it burned off the soot, but it's like with a lot of the glass systems, they're trying to get the fire to hit the glass in just the right way to keep the soot off. I'm not sure whether it's fair to say that it burned the soot off or just kind of rushed the soot off and carried it further down the system.
Yeah.
So she's saying that soot is a headache. I haven't experienced this headache she speaks of.
It's not a big deal.
I haven't had it be a big deal.
A big deal in wood stoves? Traditional wood stoves?
I'd have to say that when I ran wood stoves, I tried very hard to burn an extremely hot fire every fire to reduce creosote because I don't want a chimney fire, and I worry that I'm not burning it hot enough when I'm running a conventional wood stove. So I'm doing all kinds of things to just really get it super 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 hot. Maybe that solved whatever soot problem I might have, but I never had a chimney fire. I've heard of people who have had chimney fires, have lost their homes and some family members to chimney fires.
Yeah, me too. That's tragic. Well, moving on to happier things.
Okay.
Martin Snow has a question, and you kind of went over this, but maybe you could elaborate a little. He's coming from Arizona desert, where winters go from 85 degrees in the day to 15 or 20 at night. Has anyone thought of a good way to use the mass to channel cool air when the burner is dormant for a while? Thought of a good way to use the mass to channel cool air when the burner is dormant for a while. So I guess that's...
Well, I haven't heard of anybody doing it, but it does seem like if you wanted to... Which I don't think this would be worth the effort, but it's like, okay, well, what if you like had something so it would come on at 4 a.m. and then start sucking the cold air through the system, like you had a fan in there. So it moves cold air through the system and then it turns itself off at 7 a.m. So now the mass should be extra chilled with your more chilled night air. I haven't heard of anybody doing that, but I suppose it's possible.
It does make sense in the desert. I mean, that would make sense to do something like that. Absolutely. But in the, well, yeah, I would go with that. Yeah, it makes sense. I haven't seen a lot of rocket mass projects in the desert myself. Have you?
I was just down in Santa Fe, and it sounds like their weather is a lot like the weather we have here.
They're pretty high altitude.
Yeah, because they're like at 7,000 some odd feet. And I gave a presentation there, and I mentioned rocket mass heaters, and there was people in the audience, yeah, rocket mass heater, I have one. So, yeah, I think that a rocket mass heater seems like a smart, smart thing in Santa Fe.
Cool. Yeah, and there's a lot of high desert areas. You look at Nevada is a pretty high desert area, or parts of Nevada. Washington State has some high desert area. Anyway, next, let's move on to the next question, and that's from Kevin. Can't pronounce your last name. Kevin asks, are you going to do a video on a Tim Baker-style rocket stove water heater?
Like the one that's in DVD 4 right now? So, Tim Barker, I think is who he's talking about. And Tim Barker is amazing. He was here and taught an appropriate technology course this summer. And then he was here for the innovators event last, the two innovators events we've had here. And for the first one, he built that 3-in-1 I just talked about. And for the second one, he basically built the exact same 3-in-1, but greater, grander, better. He just is bonkers about this 3-in-1 thing. And, we got video of the 2015 innovators event. And I heard from the videographer that he is going to put together a DVD for that. And maybe he'll put together – that same videographer was here to record a bunch of – to record Tim's course that he taught here for the appropriate technology event.
And I imagine you'd be wanting to set that up with like a multi-season system so that like during the summers you'd be heating it with black hoses on the roof. So you're not having to run a fire in your house. And then during the winters, you'd be using the rocket mass for the water.
Well, the things that Tim built are portable.
Oh.
And so you could have them be in your outdoor kitchen when it's hot. Now, of course, Tim is from Australia, where it's hotter than here. And it doesn't, I don't think he even has this concept of freezing. I'm not sure if he's even seen snow ever. So I think that a lot of his designs are about how to keep the interior of the house cool but still cook outdoors.
Okay. All right. Cool. And you said they're lighter. I'm thinking about doing one in an RV. I know Cobb's heavy. If I wanted to do this thing in an RV, what would I do? Don't do it.
Well, I mean, the stuff that Tim's put together, I think it would be pretty light. But then if you're doing it in an RV, in fact, Erica was here for the appropriate technology event, and Tim taught her how to weld. And so then she then came up with something that was part steel, part masonry, that was for a boat to go onto a small boat. And we're seeing a lot of our innovators are now moving strong and fast into the area of like an indoor rocket cook stove. And so, but the thing that Erica did was indoor rocket cook stove that was pretty small. So you'd have a small cooking surface and a small fire. It was basically a 4-inch system. We're also seeing a lot of people do rocket mass heater stuff for tiny houses. And we're seeing some very interesting results. There, for the longest time, Ianto's group would say you cannot build a 4-inch system. And that had to do with the fact that they tried and they had a collection of failures. But things have progressed so much in the last 4 years that we're now seeing some great results with 4-inch systems.
Yeah, there's a lot of hunters, especially in our area, that have like truck campers, and they put wood stoves into them to heat up the truck camper during the winter when they're winter hunting. And man, it'd be great to have a rocket mass in those if it's possible, especially if it's heating up the bed or the bench, because there's a lot of air flowing underneath your camper.
Well, the other thing I'm thinking is like, you don't want to have too much mass because then it might become difficult to get around with a lot of weight in the back of your truck in addition to that camper. But I think another thing is that if you got a conventional wood stove for wood heat in your camper, what are the game going to do when they catch a whiff of smoke? Are they going to come closer or are they going to, you know, go farther away?
Well, normally these are on the – yeah, they're going to go further away. But normally these are – you know, you got your camp's site where you're going to be cooking fires and stuff anyway, and then you're hiking like 12 miles into the mountains.
And so then I would think that if your mission is to hunt as opposed to hunt, then I would think that you're going to – it's like you got to get up there, you got to get your meat and get out. then I would think you're not going to do an open campfire. And you don't want to do a conventional wood stove. But I think that, you know, a rocket mass heater or something that uses a proper J-tube or something in that space, I think that's going to be a smart thing because then you're not giving off smoke.
Yeah, it could be a game changer for hunters because they're not having to hike so far away from their campsite.
In order to get the game. Yeah. Instead, they could put out stinkums that draw the deer in so they can, you know, hunt from the picnic table.
All right, we still got 22 questions. I don't know if we'll get to them all, but let's blast through them. You're going to love the next one from Brian Wood. Are the DVDs available on Amazon to order?
No.
All right. Next question.
Stoves2.com. I've got it all set up so it's all there at Stoves2.com. But it's kind of like I'm tired of dealing with Amazon. Not only does Amazon take a fat cut, but it's like they keep changing stuff. And suddenly, oh, your listing doesn't work anymore. And anyway, so I'm just tired of dealing with Amazon. I exchanged some emails with a guy that I hoped was going to carry them on Amazon. And I'd like sell them to him by the case. And he would sell them on Amazon. But I need to talk to him some more. Or maybe somebody else listening now is like, they want to sell them on Amazon and they should send me an email.
All right. Awesome. Next question is from John Wagner. And did you install a rocket mass heater in your double wide? Answer is yes. If so, how did you support the floor? Did you replace the particle board decking?
We did. So we supported the floor by putting in some cement blocks on the ground underneath and then, you know, coming up with a piece of wood that was just the right height to support the structure that's underneath the double wide. We used a pebble style rocket mass heater inside the double wide and it's got a wood floor in it. And then it sits on rails, which are running perpendicular to the support system that's underneath the house.
All right. Next question is from Tim Mather. Sorry, Tim. Question is, you mentioned a special way to start the stove. Do you have information regarding this and how is it different from a regular fire?
We do have a 30-minute micro doc called Care and Feeding of a Rocket Mass Heater. I think we've got it available at Scubly for like $3. And it shows, it's got video clips of me starting a rocket mass heater and, you know, all the tips about caring for it and stuff like that. Then there's Ernie doing it and Peter Vandenberg doing it. And then there's one where I think it's Emily and Tony doing it. And so you've got four different people starting rocket mass heaters to get four different perspectives. And the way that I do it is different from the way that any of those other people do it. Part of it is that I think I'm lazier than those guys. Like Ernie will take a stick and whittle up kindling, like toothpick size stuff. And we give him shit about it constantly, but you know, that's the way he likes to do it. I will go to the wood pile and I'll gather up the smallest pieces I can find, which are usually like, I don't know, like that thick. So it's bigger than kindling, a lot bigger than kindling. And then we save all of our burnables. Like, you know, like a lot of households will have recycling. And so we'll have the recycling bins. And then we've got this one goes to the dump. And then we've got this one's, you know, for fire starter. And it's like, well, the best thing to put in there is one of those butter wrappers. Those are awesome. And so anyway, then the time comes like, oh, I'm going to start a fire. Well, first of all, you don't start a fire very often with a rocket mass heater. So these bags of burnables build up. And so then I just put a ton of this down. Well, not a ton. I put a lot down in there. And you got to put it back. You got to kind of fill the bottom of the burn tunnel. So to get it under the riser, because you need to prime the riser and you get the riser warmed up. And so I'll put all this paper stuff, much more than Ernie and Erica, much more than anybody else I've seen. And then I've got a propane torch where you just click the little, you know, trigger and it starts. And then you can turn it upside down. So I turned it upside down and I put the flame down into the burn tunnel and I ignite the paper that's down there a ways. And then I pull that out and turn it off and put it away. And then I plop all the sticks in there. That's what I do. That's it. It works almost every time. And I don't have to make kindling because I'm lazy.
Yeah, I noticed in some of the designs, they have the input shaft at the bottom and some don't. And so the ones that don't, or I don't see them like right in front. So maybe it's somewhere else. But the ones that don't, I imagine they're lighting it from the top down, like with one of those longer lighters. Or the ones that do are lighting it from the bottom.
I'm not sure what you're talking about. But I can tell you that, I mean, Ernie is on pain meds. And so he tends to get a ball and then he'll light the ball. And then the ball's on fire. And then I think about the time that he starts to smell burning flesh. Then he kind of does this bowling thing. There you go. And he throws it in there and hopes to get under the riser. And then he starts putting more paper in and then he puts in the newspaper. Okay. That seems to be Ernie's technique. Erica will like take a bunch of paper and she'll wad it up into something that's kind of like a long thing. And then she lights one end of it. And then she'll delicately shove it inside and then put in more paper and then put in the kindling. I'm not sure if this answers your question or not.
Yep.
I don't like the idea of having the flaming thing outside where it could put smoke into the air. I don't like the idea of the smoke being out of here. I want it all to be down in there and going up the exhaust, you know? So I like, and plus my little propane torch thing is kind of fun. I just like playing with it. It's cool.
What I'm talking about, all right, I'm not a rocket mass nerd. I don't know any of this stuff. So where you put the wood in from the top? Okay, there's also a hole on the bottom on some of these that I see. So that's for airflow, I'm assuming, or somewhere where you can light everything, and then you're putting your stuff in from the top.
I saw a picture one time of like a drawing where there's the wood feed, and then from the outside, there's like something coming at the bottom of the wood feed from the outside, and I'm thinking like, that's not a good thing.
Okay. That's my question, man. That was my question. Is why the heck is that thing there?
Yeah. You'd have to ask them, and I wonder if they actually built it, and then later they were like, we got to plug that thing up. That's ruining everything.
All right. Fair enough. Next question is from John. John asks, have you ever – okay. First of all, this question, there's a couple of questions like this, so I'm going to just ask it with John's question, guys. But it's looking for alternative ideas for RMH. Have you ever installed other systems into a RMH, aka water lines, to heat showers, or in floor heating, or in saunas, et cetera, et cetera?
Okay. Water heat. We've got in the first four DVDs, we had the DVD number 3 is called Boom Squish. And that's about water heat. And basically, if you're working with pressurized hot water, that can be very explodey and dangerous. And so when building a standard rocket mass heater, the odds that you're going to hurt yourself are about zero. So close to zero, might as well call it zero. If you're working with pressurized hot water, the odds of you hurting yourself are probably about 80% of like serious blood. That's why we call it Boom Squish. But we do have a system here. And the key is, if you're going to play with hot water, I mean, there's things to be aware of. And that's why we have an entire DVD to the topic. But if you can do a system that's not pressurized, that solves like 90% of the problems. And we do have a system here that is a non-pressurized hot water system, a rocket hot water system. And that was, you know, by Tim Barker. Tim Barker made it. Okay, so that was one of them, was hot water. But we do have an image that we use a lot at Permies, where somebody put a coil of copper pipe around the outside of a barrel, and it was a non-pressurized system. And our moving, you also mentioned about heating the floor, and I think that they were talking about heating water with the floor, and that's a possibility. And then there's, you know, some of the stuff was done in duty free of the first floor duty, but I'd say that another one would be like,
all right,
if in and out throughout the have a fire on one end, which go under the floor, and you didn't have any water. So there are rocket mass heater systems where instead of heating a bench, that they do heat the floor. I have one video up on YouTube about that. Did I get everything? Did I leave it?
Well, you just broke up a whole bunch. So my question is for you guys, was it breaking up for you or was that just my connection? I see John saying it was breaking up pretty bad for him. So maybe someone else is on your internet, Paul.
Oh, those bastards. I gotta go slap them around a little bit. Still breaking up?
No, it sounds okay now. So we'll okay. Give a couple more questions and see how it goes.
All right. There's a bunch. I'm getting a lot of messages now. Yes, very broken up, not bad now. Okay, it's okay now. Do I say all that again?
Do a quick summary of it.
Okay. We have a lot of stuff about hot water in DVD 3 of the first four DVDs. And so that one is called Wood Burning Stoves 2.0, is that four DVD set. And the third DVD is called Boom Squish. It's about heating hot water with rocket stuff. And it's just dangerous. Working with rocket mass heaters in general, you probably aren't going to hurt yourself. But hot water, especially pressurized hot water, 80% chance that you're going to seriously hurt yourself. So we really, really discourage you from doing it without really doing your research. Then I got into the thing about if you want to heat your floor, I have a YouTube video about doing that. And that is something that's pretty easy to do, but it's don't heat water and then use the water to heat the floor. Use the exhaust. Instead of heating a bench, heat the floor. Simple.
All right. So don't do pressurized. That's just kind of the basic recommendation, unless you really know what you're doing.
And a lot of people think they know what they're doing, and then they're not alive anymore.
Well, that's Darwinism. All right.
Yeah.
Next question's from Alessandro. Says, hello from Barcelona. I got in a bit late to the presentation and don't know if you mentioned what a batch box is, but I just saw the two pictures, but I don't quite understand what it is.
So the idea of the batch box is that the riser is kind of done a different way. It's kind of got this channel that you go through at the back, and then all the smoke and other gases go in between this narrow channel and then up into the riser. And then the batch box has got a great big container. I'm trying to fit into the big container. Where you can stack in a bunch of wood like you would a conventional wood stove. And then you burn more wood at once than you would with like a conventional J-tube. The problem is the door. In order to do this correctly, you need a good door. And in order to do a good door, I mean, suddenly the door becomes like 70% of the project. So it's like, doing the door takes more than double the time to do all the rest of it. And so then you've got to buy steel, you got to weld it, you got to, you know, and then even still, it's like really not as good as it could be. the J-tube is so simple and works so well, and you don't need a door. You can just use two bricks to put on top of it, and it works great.
All right. And that kind of ties into the next question from Gianni Lapis. Gianni wants to know, what's the best way to start a J-style mass stove, and do you have any advice about using it in a greenhouse?
Okay, I think I just did about a bit earlier about starting a J-tube style. And my advice for using one in a greenhouse is that they are awesome in a greenhouse. Please make sure that you send the exhaust outside. And a lot of people make the mistake of saying, oh, the exhaust is mostly steam and CO2. Plants like water and CO2. Therefore, what I'm going to do is kill all my plants and kill myself, because I don't understand that this much CO2 is different than way too much CO2. And then, of course, a human being walks in there, and there's this odorless gas inside of their greenhouse, and they go, and they die. So we've had way too many people get the idea of, like, I'm just going to vent the exhaust into the greenhouse. Don't do that. Vent the exhaust outside.
I am glad that question was asked, because that's something I would be trying. Like, ooh, what can I do here? All right. Next question is from Richard. What's that?
I said Darwin at work. You were talking about Darwin earlier.
I know. I would have been fatal to, I would have looked it up first. All right. Next question is for Richard Crawford. How big an area would
it be? There's somebody over here who's off.
Yeah, your lip sync is way off. Bad internet.
Well, it's not bothering me.
Yeah. We can still hear you. That's what's the most important to me anyway.
There you go.
Richard Crawford asked, how big an area would a 10-foot long mass heat? And to expand on that, what is the ratio of length versus area of heating?
Okay. The answer to your question is the same answer as how long is a piece of string. So there's so many variables here. I mean, how cold does it get outside? How big is the building? How well insulated is it? How tall are the ceilings? There's all kinds of other variables in here. and you say 10-foot long, and it's like, well, how wide is the bench? How tall is the bench? What's inside the bench? And then, you know, how did you design the rest of it? Like, how much heat do you have going into the bench? Because we talked earlier about having a design so it put almost no heat into the bench. And so, you know, you can do it both ways. I think to get good answers to a question like that, I would say you're going to need to spend some time getting cozy with Ernie and Erica's new book. But I guess you could watch my DVDs. My DVDs don't exactly cover that question, but I do think that you're going to see a lot of different rocket mass heaters put into a lot of different scenarios. So, for example, we've got a pretty big rocket mass heater in a teepee, which is not a really big space. And then we use much smaller rocket mass heaters in much larger spaces. So you kind of get an idea of a vague idea of answering that question. And of course, we're in Montana. The teepee is outside and uninsulated. The other spaces are insulated, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep, makes sense. There's a ton of variables. It is hard to think of building one of these systems, having to experiment, adjust things, rebuild to what your liking is, unlike a regular house wood stove where you're just buying one that you think is big enough for your area. Or they kind of, you know, because when you're buying one in stores, it's telling you, okay, if you got this much insulation, it'll heat this big of an area, like R36 or whatever insulation.
I mean, you could make estimations, you can make rough guesses and stuff like that. Even, or you could even like write down exactly, if your house is 2,500 square feet, just so you need this great big, you know, wood stove to cover that. I mean, they could say it, and then it's like, well, it didn't work. And it's like, well, you forgot to tell us that the house wasn't insulated at all, and that you were going to be living in Montana instead of Southern California. So it's like they're going to make charts and stuff, but you know they're making a lot of assumptions in those charts.
Yeah. All right, we're going to take a question from Lance Heidel. Lance asks, is there ash? If so, is it useful like biochar?
Biochar is an amazing thing if you live in the tropics. I have a lot of people who keep, you know, yelling at me and pointing at me and saying hateful things when I say that. but the bottom line is that, I mean, there are some uses for charcoal. Even though you live in the north, even though you live in a cold climate. But for the most part, they're like trying to do, because down in tropical areas, they have a really hard time keeping organic matter in the soil. And so biochar is a great solution to that. But here in a colder climate, it's like, oh, you just take a stick and you bury it and you're doing better than you did with biochar. And so it's like, why go through all those steps of making biochar? Now, there are people who've done rocket mass heaters that do build biochar. Take a look at what Willie Smits is working on. He's got some amazing stuff. There is ash, of course, and we just scoop the ash out. I'm not finding chunks of charcoal in with the ash when I scoop out the ash.
All right. Next question is from Trent, and it is a bit complicated. So Trent Snyder asks, rather than external air intake, if you had a nearby ground mass heated intake to pull fresh air in or pressurize the rocket mass heater, thus possibly putting it on par with the wood stove testing houses, would that help with the sealed envelope in many new homes?
Okay, I like the, I mean, it's kind of funny how a lot of these new homes have a sealed envelope, and now a lot of those exact same homes are being modified, or the newer homes, they are sealed, and they have a vent with a fan that will actually, like, suck the stale, because what they found is that when they put people in a sealed home, that they get sick. And so now they're trying to vent the homes, and they won't even have an air-to-air heat exchanger. They'll just suck the air out to outside and hope it leaks in from other places. I've even been to places where they've modified a home where they just put holes in the walls on either end of the structure with a grate over it, so air just passes right through. So I think what we've learned is that the sealed home thing is a really bad idea. It does work to hold heat in better when you're heating your home with convective heat. But it makes you sick. And so maybe not so good. So when we're like, to answer this question, it's like, okay, how can I design this so that I can stay sick, stay being sick? Because I love being sick. It's my favorite thing. And then I want to be able to, like, you know, add a fan somewhere. And so I want to encourage you to have it pull the air out of the room. Whenever you start to look at a rocket mass heater, I've seen people where they add a fan here or there. And I'm going to think, like, we can do this without the fan. And it's better to do it without the fan, to have a passive system. To have a system that doesn't require electricity, that still works great. I understand what he's saying about the heat tube thing. And I think if you're going to put one of those in, something that's going to warm the tube, like earth tubes is what he's describing. It's like, I'd rather see you take the air that comes through that tube and put it into the house than put it into the fire myself. But it is a way. And maybe there are things in this space that I still need to learn. But if I had an earth tube like that, like what he's talking about, I think I would use that air to go into the house for my own personal breathing luxury, as opposed to feeding it to the fire.
I would want it in the house too, I think, just so that I would not have to use the RMH as much.
I think that if I had you in my house with me and maybe some other people, and I know you guys have halitosis and BO and all your farting stuff from what you eat and whatnot, I would want that to come into the house to have fresh air coming in and then suck the air out of the room and into the fire. So that way the nasty air goes out.
Especially if I'm in there. But as far as getting sick, you know, when you have a fever, your temperature is going up by itself, so... maybe it's a good thing. Joking.
There you go. Another heat source.
Next question is from Gail. Gail asks, can you use a rocket mass heater to heat a two-story home, or how would you go about doing that?
Yes. I mean, there are homes that were designed where you had a wood stove on the main floor, and then they had vents on the second floor. I mean, I think we've all been in a home like that at some point, because you can all yell up the stairs, up to the upstairs without having to actually go to the stairs to yell, because they can hear you through that little grate. And that was so that it would allow the heat from below to go up. So that's the old school way of doing that kind of thing. A lot of times the upstairs ends up getting heated when the downstairs is warm. And sometimes closed doors prevent that. And so I think a cool thing about rocket mass heaters is that when you've got a really spread out house or something like that, you could have multiple rocket mass heaters. I do think that you can have a rocket mass heater on the second floor. The thing is, you are going to need to shore up the floor. And that's where it gets complicated. And so what are you going to do? You're going to rip out the ceiling from downstairs in order to be able to put a few 2x8s or 2x6s in there to kind of help shore up whatever's there already. It gets challenging. And so that would be the thing that's going to stop a lot of people from putting a rocket mass heater in on the second floor.
Well, what this question reminds me of is the old Victorian style German homes, where these would be like the wealthy Germans. They would have what is a mass stove that runs from the bottom story up to the top story. This is like in the middle of the house. And what would happen is the help that would work on one side of the house, and they're feeding the fire and everything. That fire is heating the mass, which goes all the way up through the house. And then on the other side is where the help would provide the food to these wealthy people. But everybody was enjoying the heat from the center of the house in this giant brick mass that went all the way through the middle of the house. It's just what I thought of.
Okay.
Next question is from Amber Meyer. Amber asks, do your videos cover rocket mass heat that incorporate water heating or ovens? Is this a feasible option? Amber, we've pretty much covered that, I think. All right. Next question is from Richard Crawford. Richard asks, my current fireplace uses natural gas to help start the wood on fire. Would something like that speed up the process for starting a rocket mass heater? Yes, I know. I am lazy.
I guess. I mean, I use the propane thing, which is effectively going to be a similar thing, only mine's handheld. I mean, it kind of takes – one of the things that I like about what we have is that it's an autonomous thing. It doesn't require anything external in order to run. And it sounds like you're going to set up something external to make it run.
Next question is from Tim Mather, and the question is, have you tried to have your rocket mass heater with the fire and exhaust outside and the mass components inside the house, thus limiting the issues around code violations and forcing you to start the fire outside?
Well, I don't know about code violation stuff as far as that goes, but I have seen two systems. I have actually lit two systems that do it exactly that way. And I don't like it. I mean, it's like, okay, how's the fire doing? I don't know. It's warm in here and it's cold outside. I don't want to go look. Why don't you go look? Well, I don't want to go look because I'm cozy. And should we add wood? I don't know. So then you got to go outside to go see how the fire's doing. And then, you know, possibly add wood and stuff like that. Maybe. So anyway, I'm just, yeah, you gain something, but I think you lose more.
I think I do. I just don't want to start a fire outside myself.
And there's that.
Yeah. Mason says the German thing I was talking about, he believes it's called a Kachelofen.
Yeah, a Kachelofen. And so when you start talking about masonry heaters, there are some amazing things. Of course, that's going to require some major rework of an existing home. I mean, you're going to – it's going to be a major remodel. And then building the thing, you're going to have a pretty high level of expertise, and it's going to take you 3 months. Or you can build a rocket mass heater on the first floor and the second floor. It takes 2 days for each one, and you know, not much money. Yeah. And it didn't require a lot of rework. And then for the upstairs, I mean, you could explore doing a small rocket mass heater. I mean, after all, I think your heat needs upstairs are probably going to be less than your heat needs downstairs. So you can probably get away with a real small one.
All right. We are 1 hour into the Q&A. We can keep going if you want, Paul, or we could take these questions offline and post.
I can try doing another, you know, 15, 20 minutes. How's that?
All right, cool. Because we've still got a lot of questions coming in. Thanks, guys. That's great. Okay. Mason, all right, Mason, I'm going to have a hard time with this one, but I'm going to give it a shot. Mason says, what do you wish you knew 10 to 15 years ago, and where do you see permaculture 10 to 15 years in the future?
Oh, man. 10 to 15 years ago.
What's the biggest thing you wish you knew?
The biggest thing I wish I knew. I think rocket mass heaters would be at the top of that list. I mean, when I found out about rocket mass heaters, I found it kind of unbelievable. And then I went and experienced them and saw them firsthand. And my first thought then was, why didn't everybody know about this already? This is profound. This is amazing and huge, and it changes the world. But okay, so 10 to 15 years ago, what do I wish that I knew then that I knew that I know now? I took my first PDC in 2005, so that's 11 years ago. I think it was 15 years ago when I first heard the word permaculture. And so,
the ethics, that's a lot. I mean, there's so much information that has been gained in those 15 years.
Wow. I mean, it's like, okay, so you send a tidbit of information back 15 years. What's the tidbit of information that I sent back? And I am not sure. Now, 10 to 15 years into the future, then I'm hoping that 7 years from now that the things that we started here 3 years ago will be finished. I'm hoping that rather than talking about rocket mass heaters, I'll be talking about Wafatis and annualized thermal inertia. I'm hoping that we'll be talking a lot about how we've cured cancer through polyculture and, you know, a list of 70 other ailments, and thus replacing medications that people require for, you know, like basically I've destroyed 80% of big pharma through just bits of knowledge. So the future I'm very hopeful for. I'm very passionate about discovering the future and what we're going to be able to figure out. But what would I go back in time to try? I mean, I don't know. I kind of feel like if I knew a lot of this, I've had this little thought experiment before, and I keep thinking, like, if I didn't go through the suffering that I went through, would I be doing what I'm doing now? If I was a green thumb, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing now, because I started with gardening. I tried to do a garden, and the garden failed. And then I became absolutely passionate, reading 100 gardening books in one summer. And, you know, I don't want to kill another little baby seedling. and so I learned so much. If I'd had a green thumb when I started, then I probably wouldn't have worked so hard to learn so much. And I wouldn't – I think I've met people with green thumbs, and they just kind of have great success without trying. But it's through all the pain that I've gone through that makes it so I think I can explain why it didn't work before and why it works now. And so without that suffering, I don't think I'd be able to convey the message.
Good answer. Yeah, that's a good answer. I think the biggest difference I've found in permaculture, like the thing that impacted me the most, or what I could do to the land, is swales. I think swales is huge. Because there was just the idea of learning, oh yeah, slow and stop water, duh. I mean, that was huge in a lot of things we do in permaculture, to slow and stop, or stop and slow water. So
okay.
In the future, I just want to see, I mean, I would like the last bastion of slavery, aka government, gone. But that's my personal opinion. Yeah. Next question is from Kyle. Kyle says, in order to get around regulating meanies, can you see a way to build the firebox insulated and outside, and have the mass inside? Okay, that was a double question. We already talked about that.
Okay.
Let's see. Jace McCrown says, has the direct heat off the barrel ever been a problem as far as overheating the room? Any benefit to using that heat to preheat intake air?
Okay. I'm going to skip the second half. I'm going to focus on the first half and say, we've done a lot of experimenting, and we've got here in the Fisher-Price house, we have a ceramic fiber shippable core. And it didn't get too hot. It was way too hot for a lot of different reasons. And so we've done some things to throttle the system down. It was burning so hard and so rockety, it was sucking the flames off of the wood. And so we couldn't keep the fire going. So it'd get up to heat and then go out because it was just pulling so much air into the system. So we throttled it back in a lot of ways. Now the wood feed is 35% smaller than what it's supposed to be. It's still an 8-inch system. But even now, when you get a fire going good and hot, and you're sitting there on the couch near the barrel, I've had times where it's like, I'm too warm. I'm going away from here. So yeah, that would be an example of too hot. It can get to be too hot.
All right. And next question is kind of similar. It's from Mitchell and says, if you have a double high barrel to output heat into the room, do you still need the bench, or can you do away with the bench?
See, now that's kind of what I was thinking when we were talking about the second floor thing, is we do have one system here that doesn't even have a mass anymore. We've disconnected the mass, and we just have what we call a rocket heater. And it still burns very clean. And so, yeah, there's – if you do that double – and it uses the double barrel to try to extract all the heat. So that way what goes out is, like, very cool. So the answer is yes, that is a system. And it works well. We use it.
All right. I've gotten this question multiple times, so I'm going to ask it. And I kind of mentioned it earlier, but they want more details. Sauna. Okay. How does rocket mass heater work in a sauna? What can you do with that?
I would say, first of all, I would say a rocket mass heater probably isn't a good idea, but a rocket heater, like we were just talking about, is probably a better idea. Because in a sauna, you don't really need it to stay warm for days. You need it to just heat up right now, and then you do your sauna thing, and then you're all done. And then the building sits empty for a week or something like that. So I would say that would be one component to not have a mass. Then the next thing is that you just need a place where you could dribble water on something hot, and that would be the top of the barrel. The end. I think that's it.
So now we're looking more at rocket heater. Do a rocket heater.
A rocket heater, yeah, without the mass.
Next question is from Carolyn Graves. Carolyn asks, is it better to have your exhaust go straight up through the roof, or is it okay to have it go up and out of a wall?
That is an excellent question. And we go into excruciating detail in DVD 2 on that topic. But in a nutshell, when we built the three rocket mass heaters the first year we were here at base camp, we built one in the shop, one in the office, and one in the Fisher-Price house. We made them all go out the wall, except for the one in the office. We had it set up so you could choose to go out the wall or out the roof. And we know Ernie and Erica demanded that we make them all go out through the roof, and I'm the one that insisted they go out the wall. Because it's a problem. Going out the wall has never been as good as going out the roof. And we thought if we can force the problem to exist, we'll come up with a solution. Because a lot of people want to go out the wall. They do not want to go out the roof. The end result is that we've never been able to solve the problem. Maybe somebody else will later. And so going out the wall low sucks. Going out the roof is best. And if you need to go out the wall high, that's like in the middle. It's going to be okay-ish. One thing I'd like to emphasize, as long as I'm in that chat, one thing we've learned is have your vertical exhaust really close to the barrel to have it be more rocky. It'll make your rocket mass heater less efficient, but it will work much better, especially with Gilligans. So if people are like, they don't really know what they're doing, but they want to help and they're trying and failing, it'll be fail light instead of fail major.
Yeah.
The system will be more forgiving.
All right. Someone had a question about the black thing behind me. It's got to be there. Sorry, guys. There's a big light there, so you'd be very annoyed if it wasn't there. We had some permaculture questions, but I'm going to try and keep this to the rocket mass stuff, guys. So the next question I have is from Amber. And Amber says, if I wanted to heat two or three bedrooms with one rocket mass heater, how would that work? Is there a limit to the length of exit?
There. Okay, I feel like I'm just trying to sell everybody on my DVDs, but on DVD 4, I made a special animation that shows what I call a stratification chamber, and it really opens things up so you can do all kinds of interesting shapes. And suddenly, the length of duct no longer matters. And so it's a way that we haven't done a lot of, but we've done some with. And so this stratification chamber. The Fisher-Price house is a three-bedroom house. And the rocket mass heater is centrally located. We close the doors at night. And, of course, like with any kind of wood stove, if you close the door, you're no longer getting heat from your wood stove. And so some people will keep their doors open at night to be able to get the heat. Now, of course, there are houses such as this one that have like another heat source in it that includes a fan, and you could turn on just the fan and it'll circulate the heat throughout the entire house. That's an option. But we leave the fan off generally, and the only time we've ever turned the fan on is when it gets really cold outside and we want to really make sure that like pipes don't break on the extremities of the structure. Then we'll turn the fan on. I would say that the thing I would stick to is the whole concept of the central rocket mass heater gets warm, and then it's going to hold heat, and you close your bedroom door, and now when you wake up in the morning in your bedroom, it's 50 instead of 70. And the way that you warm your bedroom up is to open the door. Now, that said, the other thing is that I have seen systems where they would have bedrooms that were far away from the central heat source, you know, kind of like more of a ranch-style home. And then what they do is they put more rocket mass heaters throughout. Like, you might have 4 or 5 rocket mass heaters throughout the entire house. And then, you know, if you want to heat this room, you're going to put a fire in it. But you don't, the ones on the extremities tend to be really tiny rocket mass heaters. And the one that's in the middle of the house will be the big one.
Awesome. All right. Good. We got 2 people with the same question. So Carolyn asks, can I buy a shippable core yet? And then Mike asks, are you familiar with the Liberator RMH shippable core that is UL listed?
Oh, that guy. So he's an advertiser on Permies, I think. So there is somebody I do. There's a shippable core that is the one that's the Liberator, I believe, and it's advertised on Permies.com. And I got to say that I've only glanced at it, and I have some concerns about it because it looks like a lot of steel, and I'm trying to dissuade the use of so much steel. But it's going to, in order for it to get UL listed, it is going to have to be something that's going to be a solid piece like that, all steel, something to be duplicated, because masonry stuff generally cannot survive the shipping to be UL listed. Now, I do think that I like the idea that someday there's going to be a shippable core that's going to be ceramic. Now, the other thing is that DVD number 3 in the new DVD set is all about shippable cores. I think we've got, I don't know, like 8 to 10 shippable cores in that one DVD. So we've got pourable cores, we've got ceramic fiber cores, we've got wood box style core. So we talk about, you know, lots of different styles of making cores that are shippable cores. I'm hoping that someday somebody will create a business that's going to be the ceramic fiber shippable cores. I do know that there is a manufacturer out there of a shippable core, or they claim it's a shippable core, and I have a lot of problems with that particular one. We addressed it a little bit in DVD 3. The ones that are steel, I would want to go for a tour of it. For a 4-inch system to have a little bit of steel in the wood feed feedback has been like not that big of a deal. When we've tried to use steel on an 8-inch system, it was a problem. There are further ways to mitigate these things, and I would want to see the system. I'd want to tour it. When I'm asked, I'd like to see somebody. In fact, when making DVD 3, part of the things we thought is that somebody's going to go and start a business building these styles. There's the ceramic fiber stuff, which has been proving out to be really amazing. And then there's also some designs with DuraBoard, where I think that it'll have all of the upsides of the ceramic fiber stuff. But the binder on the outside will combine to make a poured manifold, which I think a good shippable core will include a manifold, but I'm seeing a lot of shippable cores out there that don't have a manifold. And so I think that there's something that you can do with perlite and Portland cement with a ceramic fiber core, because the perlite and Portland cement is extremely lightweight. It's incredibly, bizarrely lightweight. And then if you've got this DuraBoard on the inside, then that will protect this, because the Portland cement spalls at 600 degrees, which is a very low temperature. But the DuraBoard, you can have a 3,000 degree fire in it, and you can touch the outside of it. So, you know, we're talking about like 120 degrees or 110 degrees on the outside. Well within the range of what Portland cement can tolerate. I'd like to see some of these exist and some of these businesses take off. So in the meantime, I don't know. I plug my stuff, buy my DVDs. But I think that the solution to the world's problems is going to be to have a really high quality shippable core. And for $500 to your door for $500. And right now I'm seeing shippable cores that are like in the $1,200 to $1,800 range. I'm not sure how much the one with the steel is. I haven't looked into it. I mean, the moment I saw lots and lots of steel, I thought, I know why they did that, is to get the UL listing, and that's away. But I haven't looked at it close enough. Whenever I see steel in a wood feed, I kind of think, oh, that's going to be problematic. And I hope they didn't use steel. Because when we go and we look on YouTube, you'll find a lot of people welding up rocket mass heaters. And they got steel on the inside. And they absolutely insist it's fine. And but it's like, I'll bet you that you get a month down the road, it won't be fine anymore. And first steel is going to spall. I mean, even if the temperature, if it's a 4-inch system and the temperature inside never gets above 1800 degrees and steel melts at 2600, it spalls at about 1500 to 1600 degrees. And that's where it kind of turns gray and flakes off. I don't know if you've ever seen this in steel. So it's like, it doesn't last. So, I feel like I have not given a good, solid, clear answer. I've given kind of a mealy-mouthed answer. And I guess the answer is that it's kind of complicated right now. There are shippable cores, and I would like to see a different style of shippable core. And
I think it falls into the question earlier about what do we see in the future in 10 to 15 years for permaculture. And I think this is one example, is that we'll see a lot more permaculture products come to market, like these shippable cores. There'll be a lot more competition within the marketplace, reducing cost and coming up with all kinds of crazy new ideas. And that's one great thing about permaculture, is there's so many ways to do things. I think a lot of great products are going to come out of it.
I think we have huge room for optimization. I mean, we're just getting started. And I could go on for 15 hours on this topic of where we might see optimization. And it does fit into that question of, like, what do you want to see in 15 years? But in the world of rocket mass heaters, yeah, I'd love to see some shippable cores that are of the style that I like out there in like a year or two. And I encourage people to look at DVD-3 and take all those ideas. We hereby release them to the public, release the ideas to the public domain. Don't pirate my DVD. But, you know, the ideas, yeah, use those.
Yeah, use them. Make products out of it.
Last question. I'm running out of steam here.
All right, yeah. There's only six left. Let's go with... all right. This one's specific to something someone's trying to do, so I think that's going to be the best question to do.
Okay, all right.
Dick Law asks, I have several lengths of handmade ceramic pipe, 2-inch thick, 4 foot tall, 12 inch diameter, interior diameter. I'm contemplating using one in place of the barrel and perhaps a second length ahead of the manifold and exhaust cord. What are your thoughts?
Okay, so it's 2 inches thick and it's ceramic. So ceramic is clay, solid clay. 2 inches thick? Is that what it says? 2 inches thick?
2 inch thick. It's 4 foot tall. Plus the it's got a 12 inch interior diameter. 12 inches wide, 2 inches thick. 4 foot tall.
That's got to be crazy heavy. And he's thinking about replacing the barrel with this.
And then using this, a second length of that ahead of the manifold and exhaust course.
Ahead of the manifold. Okay. I think that using that stuff to go into the bench could be smart. Ahead of the manifold would be like basically replacing the barrel. And I don't think it's going to conduct heat fast enough to be good. Because like when the heat hits the top of the barrel, it needs to, you know, expel the heat quickly. And that cools those gases so that they get pushed down. And so it kind of sounds like I'm just guessing. I don't know what the conductivity is of ceramic material, but I don't think it's like incredibly high. So like if you have a ceramic mug and you pour hot coffee into it, how long until the mug is too hot? Now, if it's a steel mug, it'll be about 1 second and then you're like dropping it. Damn! But with a ceramic mug, it's going to take it a minute, maybe half a minute to a minute. And they're like, oh, it's getting warm. I'm going to set it down and use the handle. So I'm kind of thinking that ceramic isn't going to be very conductive, which will be a problem. I'm going to say like, I mean, you can experiment in your backyard. Try it out. See what happens. Maybe it'll be cool. I just kind of think it probably won't work really well.
I think that was an awesome question, Dick. Thank you very much. And great answer, Paul.
The name is funny. I wonder if his name is made up.
Well, I think it's, you know, Richard Law, Dick Law.
There's a law about your dick.
Oh, gosh. I hope it doesn't come to that. All right. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you, Paul. What an awesome show. I hope to have this show out tomorrow. tv.permeethos.com. That's where you can find the recording. Permes.com. For those that we didn't get to your question, head over to permes.com. There's a rocket mass heater form, and I'm sure there are plenty of people that would be more than willing and happy to answer these questions you guys have. Thank you again, Paul.
Thanks, everybody.
Any last thing you want to plug or share with everybody?
Buy my things. Come to my website. It's free.
I would like to plug, if you guys want to make some money in permaculture, Paul has some awesome affiliate programs. You can check out the affiliate program at richsoil.com. And he gives a lot of money back to you guys for just sharing this information that you watched today. So definitely check that out. Make some money. That's a great way to make some money, just sharing this information with friends and family, which you'll probably already share already. So if you're sharing something already, why not make some money off of it? Thanks again, guys. This has been a great episode. Have a great week. We'll see you next Tuesday. Sorry. Yes, next Tuesday. Bye.